Oh, Father God, I thank you, Lord. Oh, I glorify you and I magnify you, Lord. Oh, Father, create heaven and earth. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. Thank you for the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. Oh, our Lord and Savior. Oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. Father, we humble ourselves right now, Father God, and we ask for forgiveness. Father, forgive, Lord. Forgive, Lord. Forgive our sins. Forgive our trespasses. Forgive all that we have done, Father God. Oh, Father God, sins that omission and commission, sins that we made, and we don't remember, Father God, just wash us with your precious blood. Oh, Father God, you say in your word in Psalm 51, that though requires a contrite spirit, a repentant heart, a heart that repents. Oh, I repent daily, Father God. I repent because I love you, Lord. Oh, and I want to say thank you. Thank you. Thank you for giving me a brand new day. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father God. Thank you for protecting me, for protecting my home, my children, my grandchildren, for protecting me on the highway, for protecting my wife, my husband. Come on, thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise his holy name. Oh, thank you, Lord. You are God, you are Lord, no matter what people say. I say, you are God, you are Lord, no matter what people say. Hallelujah. You are God, you are Lord, no matter what people say. Thank you, Father God, I thank you. Oh, Father, thank you for the precious word, for the blood of Jesus. Thank you for the power of Jesus Christ, that he showed us how to overcome the wiles of the enemy. He taught us how to fight. He is our leader. He is our Savior. He is our Lord. He is our King. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Oh, thank you. Bless your holy name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Father, we thank you. Oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, we glorify you this day and forevermore, Lord. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Thank you for Jesus. Jesus, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. You put food on our table. You put clothes on our back. You provided a way of escape from danger seen and unseen. You lose your protection and your holy angels to protect me. Me, my family, my children. Oh, you protect us all night long. You protect us everywhere, even when we were doing wrong. Thank you, Lord. Oh, come on and bless his holy name. Humble yourself unto the Lord right now in your heart. Father God, enter into my heart. Enter, let the word of the Lord enter to your heart. Jesus, come into my heart. Jesus, come into my heart. Jesus, please come into my heart. Jesus, come and take over my life. Take over my body, my spirit, and my soul right now. Take over. Take over. Ask the Lord to take over your life. Turn your life over to the Lord. Turn it over to the Lord. Whatever problems you have, whatever roadblock, whatever hurt, whatever pain from the childhood, from the past, from the present, from relationships, from friends, from backstabbers, frenemies, from evildoers, from friends and families who betray you, from evil co-workers, evil managers, from, oh, Father God, to, oh, Father God, oh, Father God, whatever you have done to anyone, whatever offenses you have done to anyone, just turn it over to the Lord and say, Lord, forgive me, it was my fault. I take full responsibility, dear Lord, for whatever actions. I take responsibility right now. I take the responsibility, Father God, and acknowledge my fault and my sin. When David sinned, David took evil counsel from a false prophet from Mesopotamia. His name was Achitophel. Achitophel was a false counselor. He is the one who pushed David into having sex with Bathsheba. He was the one who told him, you are the king. You know, everything is yours. This is your kingdom and your dominion. You know, you can do whatever you want. And you see, when we receive evil counsel, and we have people who will encourage us to do wrong things in this world. We have people who will encourage us to sin against God. Father God, we repent right now. Father God, I repent. I repent. I repent from receiving evil counsel. Evil counsels are friends. Friends that are spiritually immature. They're spiritually immature, Father God. They're spiritually immature because they do not have a relationship with God. And they live their lifestyle is far away from God. those are the people that when they see that you want to do right, they will encourage you to do wrong. Just like it happened with David and Absalom. Absalom was the son of David. One of David's wives raped one of his daughters. That was Absalom, David's sister. And Ahithophel who helped Absalom to flee into another country. Ahithophel who gave Absalom the counsel, evil counsel, to go ahead and pretend and declare the judge in the city. And, you know, when influencing people, making friends and influencing people, he influenced them in their wrongdoing and they joined together, evil gatherings. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Father God, every frenemy, every hypocrite in my life, Father God, cast them out, 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 out. Break and release them from satanic, from evil friends, from evil counsel. Everything that is evil, everything that is addiction, addicted to what? To porn, addicted to the psychic hotline, addicted to reading, addicted to alcohol, addicted to sex addiction, any type of addiction, idolatry. Father God, remove idolatry right now. I humble myself. Any form or source of idolatry. They idolize their cars, their home, their jewelry, their diplomas, their degrees. Every kind of pride, Father God, break pride away from me and cleanse me, O Lord, from all unrighteousness, from all superfluity. Oh, Father God, we humble ourselves right now. I want to be humble, O Lord. I want to be humble. I want to be meek. The word humble means meek, submitting to God and doing God's will. The word humble don't mean like you are a doormat for other people to run you over because you are Christians. Turning the other cheek doesn't mean that you must allow everybody to buffet you, slap you, and spit in your face. Turning the other cheek is knowing that the person is spiritually blind and you're trying to teach them and trying to tell them something and they will jump up and insult you. Then you turn and turn away and turn your cheek and say, okay, I'm going to turn away with a soft answer because this person has spiritual problems. She is possessed. He is possessed. He got an evil spirit. He don't know God. He don't know the things of God. He is spiritually immature. Some people are spiritually immature in our families, in our home. Some husbands, some wives are spiritually immature. The children are spiritually immature. Father God, in the name of Jesus, give me your mercy, give me your grace, and make me humble. Make me humble like David as a warrior. David was humble. That's why God forgave David, because he received evil counsel. But David had to pay a price for his sin. Oh, Father God, have mercy upon me, Father God. Those irrevocable laws that you have written in the heavenlies, in the cosmos, Father God, forgive me, Father God. Let the blood of Jesus deliver me, Father God. Let my penalties not be carried out against me. Let my penalties that I must pay because of my sins, let them not be carried out against me, Father God. Stop them with the blood of Jesus. Oh, Father God, revoke those penalties right now. Revoke them in my life, in my children's life. Revoke those penalties, those spiritual penalties that we must pay when we sin. The day we sin, we shall surely die. The wages of sin is death. But God says, oh, Lord, sometimes the consequence for our sins is to live with a disease like HIV. The consequence could be HPV. The chances are some cancer. Some people did not come out 100%, but they enter into the kingdom. And God wants to save souls. And God wants to encourage you. And God wants to save you. And God wants to deliver you. Oh, thank you, Father, Jesus, and the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I say thank you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the blood of Jesus. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for his life on this earth. Thank you, he's our Savior, our Creator. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Glory be to his name. Thank you, Lord. And today, we're going to be teaching to strengthen the body of Jesus Christ. God is not through with me yet. God is not through with none of us. Life, living is a process of learning. If we look at Christianity, the way of God wants to show all his children and the believers Christianity is just a lifestyle. It is a lifestyle that was created by Almighty God through Jesus Christ for us. So we can enter into eternal life knowing right now that we have gained eternal life through Jesus Christ. Every Christian must understand that from the day you accepted the Lord, your process started. God is going to bring you through a process of deliverance. He said, come as you are. See, Jesus didn't come seeking those who were okay and right or presumptuous. He called, he went with the publicans. He went in the ghetto. Jesus went into the ghetto, not only into the ghetto, into the bars, into the streets, into the highways. He went to Samaria, he went to all of what, in the lands of the Gadarenes. He went even in the foreign land, seeking those who were lost. He did not come to seek the proud. The proud looker and the proud doer. He did not come looking for those who say, I'm a scribe, I'm a Pharisee. I'm the son of Sheba, the high priest. He didn't come to look for those who, he came to look for those who was in the gutter. You see, I am the type that go down in the gutter. I go down and I get real dirty, and I beat up the devil. I go and I strangle him every day. I strangle him. We're strangling him right now. We will destroy him. Right? We will burn him up right now. That's the type of calling that I have. Everybody don't have the same calling. But that's the kind of calling that I have, and many have rejected. Believe me, I've been in many churches. I have built many churches in this city. I have built. But then the rejection, oh, you are a woman. You are this, and you got addiction. You got that heavy Puerto Rican accent. You got to learn how to speak American. I said, well, thank you. And Jesus was a Nazarene, you know. He was from the ghetto. Nazarene was a ghetto. That's where Jesus grew up, and he was there. He was there amongst those us, and they told him, who is your dad? They even tried to say he was a bastard child out of wedlock, like his mother committed adultery. So who is your, are you the son of the carpenter? Poor people. So we find that same negativity spirit in the church today, and God is telling us through all Christianity, Christians are being slaughtered like lambs to the sheep, where all kind of violence, spiritual violence, you see, if you have a pastor that believes in deliverance, I believe in deliverance, and because Jesus taught of how to do deliverance, and that deliverance is a form of bondage where even people in the church is in bondage. The people in the church is in bondage, because there's no one there to aid them. There's no one there to protect them. And we're living in a condition called family witchcraft bondage. That's the title today. Family witchcraft bondage. And some people might say, well, it's a generational curse. But the activities of the witchcraft bondage that you can pinpoint in certain families, and I myself, all of us have seen these type of families, that you can see the fruits. What is the fruit? Is the work, the pattern of their lifestyle is so obvious in the community, in the village, that you know. And you will hear grandmother or mama say, I don't want you playing with those people over there, because I don't want that problem over here. So stay away from over there. And sometimes, at the time, you will feel bad because one or two of them, one child will come around and to play, and you will have to hide in the backyard and say, let's go over here by the bush and play with the child. Because the family is sick. There is a family bondage, a family activity bondage. And we're going to ask the Lord to bless this word today. Father God, bless this word today. Open up their eyes and their mind so they can see. I want you to, your spiritual eyes, and we'll see the things that Jesus, see, Jesus was a warrior. Let's put it this way. Jesus was a warrior. And Jesus was a spiritual warrior. Jesus came into this world not to make a name for himself. But Jesus knew his calling. Jesus knew that he was supposed to die to set us free. But he could have came and just died as a baby. But he came and he lived as a human being in the flesh and blood, And when we read in our word that we say we are touched by our infirmities, like he can feel what we feel. He said it's touched by what we're going through. You see, Jesus knows what we're going through. He was hungry. He was thirsty. He knew he was an outcast in his community. He came from the poor north side, the other side of the railroad track, from the ghetto, from the poverty. You know, he was a descendant of the people who was enslaved. So Jesus can identify himself with me, with you, with the people who are addicts, the people who have spiritual problems. He was there, he cared, he saw, he felt, he touched, and he had compassion, but he did something about the condition. You see, when you're in a condition and you see a brother and a sister, you say, okay, God bless you, you say, I don't got nothing to eat. I'm not feeling good today. And you don't say a prayer, or you don't give a dollar, or to eat. You know, that's your brother and your sister in Christ right then and there. You see, they got these churches where people have paid 20, 30 years, and when God said bring it into the storehouse so there could be plenty of meat, they keep the meat is for the pastor and his wife only. The meat is for everyone. Because in Christianity, when Paul and Peter and all the apostles, they built Christian communities, and the people who had possessions, who were converted to Christianity, took all their possessions and sold it. And they unified all their possessions and their money together and built Christian communities, and nobody had any lacking. There was no one lacking. So if you're in a church and you see people lacking, something wrong with that man of God or that woman of God. Because if she's wearing $2,000 or $3,000 suits, an instrument driving a nice car, and somebody over here is struggling because they can't pay their rent, they can't eat, they even their old credit cards, but they're paying their tithes. Something is wrong with the leader. Christianity is a good thing. But in America, they want to make it sound like a dirty name. So if you proclaim that you're a Christian, you must walk with your head down. You must be, oh, y'all Christian, this, y'all Christian. Y'all can know Christianity is a good thing. Or we go walk in power from henceforth in authority because we are Christian. Christianity is power. I got a couple people on this line that who were there the very day when the two nurses, the two RN, checked the woman who was on the floor. She had died. The woman levitated in the air and the pastor ran. He ran, and I came from behind, and I said, no, and I started rebuking her. She was laying there for 30, 40 minutes. There was no breath of life in her. So God is a God of miracles. God's hand is not short, like he cannot stretch forth his hand from heaven spiritually and bring back the dead. And there was a miracle in that church. You see, what the head of that church, he rejected it because he does not have the Holy Spirit. And you have many leaders today, they have a form of godliness, but they did not have the power thereof because they're in cahoots with Satan. They have sold their soul to Lucifer, they're Freemasons, they're China, they're this, they're that, they got secret society, they pay their tithes to the devil. I'm talking about Christian leaders. There are actually pagan Christians in the church. And they do rituals and ritualistic demands in the church. But behind closed doors, because they don't want you to see that. And this is a word to the wise. Beware where you go and worship. Examine and test the spirit to see if the spirit is a spirit of God. Because as you grow in the spiritual war, you are engrafted now. You are a soldier. You don't have a choice. It's either life or death. The word of God said, choose this day who you're going to serve. You're going to serve Lucifer. You're going to serve Jesus. You're going to serve God. We're going to fight. We'll side you on. You can't be lukewarm. One day you're saved. The other day you don't save. One day you're in the light. The other day you're in the dark. God said he will what? Spew you out of his mouth. God said he will spit you out of his mouth. And also he said, he come out. They said, oh, the Holy Spirit never leaves. The Holy Spirit will leave the church. Ishama means the Holy Spirit, God. So you've got the devil in here and nothing but the place. There's a playpen for the devil. That's a playground. You've got devils and demons, aliens here, devil worshiping. And many of them say, oh, this is a man of God. This is a woman. No, a man and a woman of God is going to teach you the truth. It's going to teach you the fight. It's going to teach you the war. It's going to teach you to use even cry. You can get mad. You can boss. You can get mad. But the man and the woman is not going to compromise the word of God and put herself or himself in hell for you. I say your blood will never be on my hand, because everything that I teach, I tell you, go research it and you can find it. Now we're going to continue teaching about Jesus and about these things that what families and ladies and people who are born, they're born in an environment in their family, and they inherit struggle traits of their families. The curses is what you inherit. You don't inherit the sin. Now, if the papi and the daddy committed adultery, the baby is not an adulterous baby. But because of the condition and the family, the spiritual condition and the spiritual bondage that the family or the mother is in, the child pays for that. The children is just getting cursed. Deprivation, abuse, mental, poverty, physical abuse, sexual abuse in the home, all of these are activities of witchcraft bondage. Many people are suffering today because of what their grandfather did, their grandmother, their great-grandfather did. So we have an ancestral curse in a picture. If you picture the ancestral curse, it's a family tree. You've got this one, this man and this woman who married, and they produce, and they produce, and they keep reproducing. But it's all curses. The tree, the root, you got to go down to the root of the problem. Or else they will never be set free. And it's Jesus, it's the blood of Jesus don't enter in there, into that heart, and cleanse. And is that a person don't get deliverance? That person can claim the Christian 50,000 times or a million. But if the blood of Jesus don't come in, if Jesus don't enter, if the Holy Spirit don't do a deliverance in their life, they will never live a righteous life in God's eyes. They will be saved, but they will struggle and they will become a living sacrifice for Lucifer. And that's why we have a lot of spiritual problems, not only in the home, but on the job. You find people like this, you find them in the school system, you find them everywhere, you find them on the streets, they're criminals. They got a criminal mind. And it's also a consequence of that is the DNA, and that will be another plan. Because on Monday, my line shut down. The prayer line was shut down. Nobody could hear me. That activities of the devil. Everybody mad but me, by Lucifer. And we start. It said traditional sin in families from one generation to another, such like incest, drug, and alcohol addiction, also polygamy, and rape, violence, crimes, custom, poverty, genetic disease, premature death, religious belief, and blood witches, children conceived on the witchcraft. It may not happen in your mama's life, but it happened way back then. And nobody, that curse has not been broken. It has to break. It has got to be broken. It got to be broken. You see, and if it's not broken, sometimes in a family, only one escape. Only one of them will escape. So they will run away from their family because they get the wrong. Sometimes they run away and they will run away and they won't come around their family. I've met people who say, Pastor, everybody in my family is crazy, murder, all of them, all the men them are bad and all the women are prostitutes. And when I accepted the Lord, I was 15 years old and I did like this and I joined the military and I ran away from them. I don't come around them. When they tell me somebody bye, I say, okay, bye, and I don't come. Because those families, and when you talk to them, the more you talk to them, you will find out, oh, my great-grandfather was a roof worker, and you're killing a lot of people. Oh, this, that. And you start digging deep. You find out the root of the problem. So the root of the problem is, in that generation, in that family tree, there was wickedness going on. And it says here in the book of Job, chapter 34, verse 22, there is no darkness nor shadow of death where the workers of iniquity may hide themselves. No worker of iniquity can hide from God, from the light. Jesus is the light of this world. So therefore, you are a light. If I don't care what your family did. I don't care what your great-great-great-great-grandmother and the great-great-great-grandfather did. But if today you are in Christ Jesus, it's broken. Now there's some consequences that are written in the spiritual world curses, those consequences that will follow you. But you will be delivered. You will be delivered as you learn through praying, through fasting, through learning how to bind and loose, and through casting away those evil spirits. And in the spiritual realm, when we do deliverance, we call them bill collectors. Those are spiritual bill collectors. Because familiar spirits carry information about your family tree up to 700 years. They can't go past 700 years in the bloodline. And those familiar spirits carry briefcases. And those briefcases carry information with your date of birth, everything what your grandmama Annie did, and they will convey it to those Luciferian satanic pastors, psychic readers, and that all the readers know about you. Because they can see all the evil with their left eye. Anything in the spiritual realm, they can see you and they can read you with the left eye. And with the right eye, they can see in the natural. And these are things that while I was delivering people in a ministry when I was for 7 years, I would ask the witches to confess. And see, those evil spirits would speak to me. And sometimes it would be 3, 4, 5 people around because those were spiritual. There were those people that were underneath me as prayer warriors. So those soldiers, they would listen and see certain things. They would even see people. They would even see one young lady was standing there, several of them, and she went with me around, but she also went through her own personal deliverance because of her ancestral curses. She saw the snake come out the woman's throat. Years ago, up in Rainbow Drive, there was an African church, the man turned into a snake, and everybody went running. But you see, these things are spiritual, but they don't happen every time. They have, when they manifest themselves when somebody is anointing. You see, you right now may be anointed, but you don't know. Because your spiritual muscles has not been exercised or need to be developed. That's why you're in boot camp. So that anointing that God has given you has to grow. It's just like when you have a child that is intelligent. The child may be very, very intelligent, but if you don't teach that child how to read and write, that child, you know, it's a terrible thing. You got bright stars. You call them bright stars, very intelligent children. Children that have a calling and a destiny in Christ Jesus. And bad things will happen to them. They will get sexually abused or battered or something. Something bad will happen in their lives. And then they just change. And then those people go up, and one day God will deliver them. I say, deliverance is on the way. Deliverance is in your life. Now we're going to talk about, in my book here on page 105, ancestral curses. It says here in the book of Psalm 94:16, "He will rise up for me against the evildoers. Or he will stand up for me against the worker of iniquity." Psalm 94:16. That is God Almighty speaking. That is the voice of God. And we say all of us are very familiar with the word sin. Everybody know what is sin. We often confuse it with the word curse. You see, there's a difference in the balance between curse and sin. The consequence of sin is a curse. Anytime you sin, there is a curse, there's a penalty. So that penalty starts, you pass it on to your children. In the environment, those children them are hopeless, they're helpless, and they're spiritually immature. They can't fend for themselves. They don't even know what is right from wrong. They don't know what is good and evil. So they become to the age of accountability. It says here, we cannot inherit our ancestors' sins But we do inherit the evil patterns and generational curses, and as you can find out in Deuteronomy 28:15 also. Nevertheless, we have to make a choice to either follow in the evil path of our ancestors or continue to live in sin. We'll repent from our sins, and the curses will be nullified through the precious blood of Jesus Christ. That's the only way you can destroy curses, demons, anything, is through the blood of Jesus Christ. I said there is power in the blood. There is power, 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 power in the blood. There is power in the blood. Only through the blood. I said the rituals that the voodoo priest told them can help them. None of the rituals can help them. None of the sacrifice can help them. But only the blood of Jesus. Only Jesus can save our soul. Only Jesus can destroy the curses, the demons, the devil. Only the one can put the devil to our end. He can save the devil from you is Jesus. There is no greater power, but the greater power is the power of the God. The blood of Jesus is the only thing that can save us. It's the only thing that can deliver you. You see, God has his people, but the masquerade in the church is the Luciferians, Lucifer people. They got a form of godliness, but they deny the power. Because if a man or a woman is anointed, and they go into a church to preach and offer the preaching, they can actually, God will let you see who is spiritually sick, and your spiritual eyes will let you see this one is a drug addict. This one is in bondage of alcoholism. You can see the drunkard spirit. You can see them even when you're walking in the natural. You can see a vagabond spirit. You can see a harlot spirit, a prostitution spirit, and someone. But you have the gift of the Holy Spirit. Pray for that person right then and there. That person will start saying, I'm buying this spirit. I'm doing spiritual deliverance right there on the spot. No. They don't do that because they deny the power of God. They'd rather be money changers and get your money as to how much you're making. What did I tell them? I was an engineer. I was in. But you were at AT&T? I was in. I was in the clam of the clam, but I'm humble. That's why I say, what is this? This is not of God. This is, who can give $1,000? All the time I stand up and give $1,000. And who can help this sister with this and that? I'll pay this one bill, this one like this. That's the type of person I was. I was young. I was 28 years old, and I was controller of the currency at the Southern Command. I controlled the funds. I controlled the money. I was making good money. I had a house in Hawaii. I was living large. But I loved the Lord, so all I did was help people. I'll feed the homeless on the weekend in Waiwa on the beach. So you see, when I came to Atlanta, I did the same thing. When the government sent me here to work, I did the same thing. So you see, your lifestyle must always line up with the word of God. If you truly love him, that's why he asked, Peter, do you love me? Three times. Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep. The spiritual food, the spiritual truth from the word of God. Learning how to overcome the ism and the schism of the devil. Go down to the root of the problem. Those curses can be only destroyed through the blood of Jesus. The word says in Jeremiah 31:29-30, but it shall come to pass that if thou wilt not hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command thee this day, that all the curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. The curses will come. Deuteronomy 28, the curses are upon the children. The curses fall upon us. And the only way we could get rid of it is through living a righteous life in Christ Jesus. You see, the churches don't want you to live right. They will tell you perversion is okay. Divorce, you can sell married and that's all. No! These things are not to be. The Savior, what is a curse? There are spiritual curses, and there are physical curses. Both curses in the spiritual manifest in the natural. Spiritual curses are manifested in the natural. Innumerable people in the world today have inherited a form of evil traits and curses from their family. And some of them this day are still Christians. And you can read Psalm 106, verse 38. That's my Bible point. Psalm 106, 38. You say, curse shall not be in the city, and curse shall not be in the field. Deuteronomy 28, 16. Why do we carry curses? It is Almighty God's spiritual law. Remember Adam and Eve? We were not present in the garden. We were not even born until thousands and thousands of generations later, but we inherit those same curses. Women give birth in pain and sorrow. Our women, our husbands, are rule over us. Psalm 115, verse 4. The man shall eat from the labor of his sorrows, must work on by the sweat of his brow. And say to this thing, curse shall be thou in thy basket and in thy store. Deuteronomy 28:17. So whatever sin we have committed, whether it's adultery, fornication, we cheat, the job, we must ask God to forgive us, even before we pray. Repentance means I'm going to make a drastic change, but I'm not going to go back and eat my own vomit. You see, putting it that way. You can't go back. The word of God said, be still and know that I'm God. You got to be still from man and let God take over our lives. We got to turn over our body. If any Christian don't turn over their body, they are in error. They're living in error because your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. If you're living with a man or a woman, or you're fornicating, or you're committing some act of homosexuality, perversion, masturbation, something ain't right. Your body has to be turned over to God. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Your body is supposed to be a living sacrifice unto the Lord, a praise, a temple of praise and worship to the Lord. Filled with positivity, ready to destroy negativity. That's what the body decides. Every Christian has to turn over their body and their spirit. Yes, you must be filled with the spirit of truth and the word of knowledge. Your body, your spirit, and your soul. You must ask God to cleanse your soul on a daily basis. So you turn over your body, your spirit, and your soul. Your mind is supposed to be the mind of Christ. Having Christ in your life, bringing in Christ on a daily basis in your life. That's what we're doing now. We're doing spiritual warfare, prayer, spiritual self-defense. We're teaching biblical studies. Every day we are eating that spiritual bread. God said man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes out of his mouth. So on a daily basis, we feed in that spirit man. Because remember, we live in two worlds. We live in a spiritual world, so when you go to sleep, you're going to dream. You're going to get spiritual attacks, satanic dreams. Something going to happen when you're sleeping. You may remember, we might get up and say, I didn't dream anything. God didn't want you to remember. But in the spiritual ground, not the ground of the mind, the Bible says, do not conform to this world. To the rudiments of this world. We talk about the image of the beast on the TV. You can't be conformed to that. You can't be conformed to satanic rituals on TV. People then with the gospel of perversion, these homosexual acts and movies. You can't be watching those TV shows on a daily basis. Sports is okay. But God confirms that sports is okay. But certain programs and certain cartoons that don't fit your child age, your child should not be watching Harry Potter, all them satanic stuff, evil movie monstrosities, just the videos with the satanic rituals, cursing, the curse Jesus, the rap, the curse the young girl, they call them the B word. Are you a Christian? No, you are Luciferian. You already told us on Super Bowl that you love Lucifer. And you're dealing darkness and light when that while you did your wet black, pitch black when you do your rituals. So we know we understand that we cannot be conformed to this world. But be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind through what? through the washing of the word, daily basis, the word of God in your life. That the word of God will wash away all the filth from your brain, from the brain matter. That's the only way you can get the seal of the Holy Spirit. Some people have the mark of the beast in their forehead already. They believe in Lucifer. They believe in everything goes. They go now with the Harlem Shake. The Harlem Shake is nothing but Eastern mysticism. It's come from Kundalini, from India, from the Queen of the Sea, from the Mami Water, from the Genie. Those are the gods that they worship. And Kundalini is nothing but Harlem Shake. It is a sexual move, but it puts you in a trance. And that's what they like. They like all this hoopla and all this stuff. And you see Christians bring even hip-hop in the church. They don't even understand what is the meaning of what does hip-hop mean. It is sexual and it's perverted. It's your hip-hopping to a sexual beat. It belongs in the world. You see, Satan has disguised himself as an angel of light and entered into the church. These things are witchcraft bondage. They are cursed. And the word of God says, here, if you do not believe me, just go to their medical doctor, in my book, and he will ask you about your family illness and your parents and your siblings. Your uncles, for instance, every family member dies of the same disease. And you can read about that in Psalm 135, verse 15. It says, yet the Lord shall send upon thee cursing and vexation and rebuke in all that thou set thine hand to do, unto thou be destroyed, and unto thou perish quickly because of thy wickedness and thy doings whereby thou hast forsaken me. You see that Deuteronomy 28:20. Even God says, well, anything you do is going to be cursed. You're not going to prosper. People in the church have curses. They are full of curses and sickness and disease that need to be broken through the blood of Jesus. Several types of sickness can only be due to poor nutrition, but some of them are infirmities that is caused in the supernatural realm. The Lord, that's Isaiah chapter 2, verse 8, the Lord shall make thee a pestilence to cleave unto thee until he has consumed thee from the land wherever you goest and possess it. That's Deuteronomy 28, 21. We must examine our family tree with both physical and spiritual realm. There you will find the root of your ancestral curses, your chronic sinful patterns of behavior, and constant spiritual battles. Isaiah chapter 2, verse 18. The Lord shall smite thee with consumption, and with a fever, and with inflammation, and with an extreme burning, and with the sword, and with a blasting, and with mildew, and they shall pursue thee unto thou perish. Deuteronomy 28:22. There is only one way that we can destroy ancestral curses. Repent from our past and present sins, covenants, oaths, rituals, sacrifices, idolatry, and witchcraft. In the book of Matthew 10, verse 1, and thy heaven that is over or thy head shall be brass, and the earth that is under thee shall be iron. That's a curse. That's why you see so much people in poverty, and they don't know how to come out of it. In mind confusion, the mind is confused, they see mental illness, they don't know how to come out of it. There are even evil spirits that people pass down to their children, and their children become possessed. You can take your child in a daycare, and when the child come out like a little devil. Because whoever is in that daycare is doing witchcraft. It says that you must have faith in God through Jesus Christ and summon it into your mind. It is impossible to please God without faith. Believe in every word of the Bible. Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 and 8. The Lord shall make thee, the rain on thy land powder and dust, famine. He will bring famine in the land. From heaven it shall come down upon thee, and thou will be destroyed, even a tornado. It's not talking from heaven. Deuteronomy 24. The only way to be free from curses is truly to repent. And turn your heart, your body, your spirit and your soul from the path of eternal destruction. John 3:16, for God so loved the world. The Lord shall cause thee to be smitten before thine enemies. Thou shalt go out one way against them, and flee seven ways before them, and shall be removed from all the kingdoms of the earth. That's what's going on. And we see that pattern on a daily basis. Your free will power must be in action and ready to accept that our Father has predetermined for you and your children through the Lord Jesus. God has made provision for us. God has asked us to fulfill certain requirements. You have to fulfill certain requirements and trust and obey the Lord in order for you and your children to be free from these curses in your generation, in your bloodline. And you can read about it in Isaiah chapter 2, verse 20. And thy carcasses shall be meat unto the fowls of the air and unto the beasts of the earth, and no man shall fray them away. You cannot serve God your Father and serve the prince of darkness. Many follow the evil doctrine of the Nicolaitans today. They are called Christian pagans. They said the Lord will smite thee with a box of Egypt, and with the emerald, and with the scab, and with the itch. Wherefore, thou canst not be healed. Sickness can originate due to disobedience of helpful laws and cleanliness, excellence, sexual promiscuity, and the spiritual laws can set them in order by generational curse and due to witchcraft practices. You can read more about that in the book of John, chapter 11, verses 25 and 26. The Lord shall smite thee with madness and blindness and with astonishment of heart. And we see many young people today, many people in the church have inherited the spirit of madness. They got the soft, mad spirit that a man or a woman will come in and they never talk. They never say nothing. They never smile. You see, the face is just straight. They carry a straight face. What is this? If you talk to them, they will start speaking madness to you, stupidness. Then you have another one that is an in between madness. So they call them war mad people. They just walk the street and talk to themselves. They just talk to themselves, curse, talk to themselves. They don't hurt nobody. It's just a demon of madness talking to them and just cursing, and they're looking up and they get the argue, they stand up and they talk and they talk and they answer themselves. That middle madness, that's one. But they got one called heart madness. This is a dangerous type. That heart madness, they listen to voices, they hear in the voices, and those people will kill you. They will pick up a gun, run in a school, kill people, kill themselves. So those are curses, those are demonic stuff, but also because of the irrevocable law of God, the people of the satanic kingdom of darkness have certain access to those powers through the demons to call judgment against your life. Certain witches, they can see your spiritual condition and they can read you. And when one of your enemies go and say, well, I want them to be destroyed, I want this to happen to this person, then that witch will act upon that spiritual law and you will be destroyed. And that's why you see a lot of Christians are suffering, because they are open book. You can read them. Now, witches get mad because they can read them. There's a part in the Word of God say that your life is hidden. Your life is hidden in Christ Jesus. So, that part of the Bible, when it says that your life is hidden in Him, is Colossians chapter 3, verse 3. You can look it up. So when the witches try to read you, they can't read you. Even if they have your date of birth, never give nobody the time when you were born. See, those spiritual laws, people want to understand why witchcraft works, why voodoo works, why all of this stuff works against certain people. It works. Because they don't have a spiritual wound covering. They don't have a covering from God. They don't have a strong prayer life. They don't study. They don't have to live far away from God, but they go to church every Sunday. It's as a religious act. It's just a religious act as a behavior, but there's no spirit in there. So therefore, you see them in church and they have spiritual problems. And I wonder when they don't invite me to come to these churches often, because when they invite me, the people run behind me, they say, oh, she's going to destroy my church. So the word is out. They bring her here because, you know, some people with small churches want their church to grow. They will ask me to come and go from 10 people that Sunday, and the next Sunday is like, room is the church is packed up. So the people are looking for spiritual healers. But there are two types of spiritual healers. They have some that pretend they are spiritual healers, but they're clinical witches. They're root doctors. The clinical witches, I have it in my book, they present themselves to you in the name of God. And they will tell you, God, tell me to tell you something, and Jesus said to tell you something. But you're dealing with a witch. So the word of God is this spiritual warfare. You will learn the difference between which is a clinical witch, a spiritual satanic healer, if she has no healing in her. All she carries with her is death. She's a spiritual murderer. They need to put here spiritual murderer instead of spiritual healer, spiritual murderer. They claim they can bring back the husband. They are red witches. They claim that can do romance. All of that is they are red witches. Red witches. A red witch specialized in romance. A white witch will do things for you and say, okay, this is not going to hurt nobody. Hey, she's a good witch. No, she's a witch. She's a spiritual murderer. But a black witch would straight up, they do everything. They kill, they destroy. They are the worst type of people. They take money from you. They look at you and they put a spirit on you so you can keep coming. They do all kind of stuff. And you find out in voodoo, wicca, wizardry, it's everywhere. It's just called different names. And the one who stands behind the scenes are the fallen angels, the evil spirits, and Lucifer, the devil himself. He is the king of this party. That's his game. And they will game you like that. You see, people of God don't know the truth. They don't know what they're going through. They look at their family tree, and you can look at the family tree and you can say, okay, yes, my mom or my uncle did this to me, blah, blah, blah. They can say that. But they don't know why certain people in their family don't want anything to do with God. Blood witches now. Blood witches are consumed by incubus demon. A woman can get impregnated in the spiritual realm. I'm dealing with someone with three people like that right now. These women are going to be raped in the ninth season, and it happened to men too. I minister to men, and they went through deliverance through the power of the Holy Spirit. They got delivered. The demons will take upon them the form of a man and a woman, and they will present themselves and have sex with them. And the next season, they will have sex and molest them, and also they will be impregnated in the spiritual realm. How do you know that you are being impregnated by a spirit husband? Is a demon that will attach himself to you in the spiritual realm, or a wife that will attach herself to the man in the spiritual realm. And the man, usually, they will create problems and chase away the lover and chase away the boyfriend or the husband. And they will be single because they want to keep them isolation. Isolation is one thing that their spirit husbands look for. Satanic soul ties will bring this. It will come through covenants. Some people go into rituals. They take satanic communions. And sometimes it's an incubus demon, a spirit husband that's in the family. It's been in the family for generations having sex with women in the family. And these things that have happened have not only became a Christian yesterday. I've been saved for 48 years, no, not 49 this year. I've been saved that long. So I've been in ministry for a long time. So these spirits will attach themselves to the little girl and take away her virginity. That's what they do. And these are evil spirits, fallen angels, Nephilians, and I have a class that I teach about that, but right now, we don't have the time. For these are evil spirits that many times how you can know that a woman or a man will have a spirit wife. And that's what we call the mammy, the mermaid spirit. The mermaid spirit will come around in the ninth season, and she belongs to the kingdom of the marine, of the Indian Ocean, the solar worshiper, the queen, and the Bible talk about the queen of the heavens is Astora. You know, the Bible talk about it too. Everything is in the Bible. You see? Everything is there in the Word of God. And what this mermaid spirit would do, she would come in the night season and romance him and have sex with him. Sometimes the men will wake up and they see themselves wet. And they will say, I don't know what is this happening to me. And Pastor, I'm just happening. I had a fight with my wife, and this thing was attacking me in the night, and I think it's a woman, I'm having sex with a woman in my sleep. Then the man will be single sometime, and he sees something waiting in his bottom or something like that, and they will come and tell me, or they dream that they have a son. And they dream, and they say, I see my wife in the spirit. I see her. And they will see the wife, and they will see like they have a baby. They will be holding this baby, and they will see that they have two or three sons. It happens to men. But it often happens to women. When a woman dreams that she is pregnant, and she don't give birth in her dream, or she's pregnant in her dream, automatically, I will know that she has a spirit husband. She has a demon attached to her, and they think it's nothing. A lot of these women, they don't think it's nothing. But sometimes they'll be sleeping, and they feel like somebody is trying to have sex with them, or they will feel that actually something is penetrating, or they will feel that they can't move, or something is pushing them down. Those are spirits of them. Those are incubus and succubus demons. And these thoughts happen to women. It's called, I have it here, it says, blood which is conceived by incubus, Nephilim, and fallen angels, will come from a long lineage of a family tree of witches and warlocks, root workers, voodoo priests. They conceive to carry on the family bloodline and tradition. They are only can be married to a witch from a generation of generations that generation of witches. And let me tell you what happened to a young lady. There's a young lady, she's African American. She was married only for 6 months to a man from Ivory Coast who was a blood witch. She gave him his papers, his green card. Back in the day, it's easy to get do that. They changed the laws now. And after 6 months, he flee and went to Canada. She's been living to this day on the torment. She did not want to come out of her torment. She is still in love with the man, and the man is gone now, Texas, somewhere. She don't know when yet. And he has had children in other women, but you see, they had a wife prepared for him. He has to go back. This girl was so in love with this man. He flees from her. He has to go back to that particular wife to produce. She's barren. She has been never able to produce a child with him. So you see, you have to want to be delivered. When a person don't have faith, that's what we studied yesterday, if you don't have the faith through in Christ Jesus, how God gonna deliver you when you don't believe? That's why you gotta be still. Be still and know that I'm God. The Word of God said, be still and know that I'm God. You gotta just make up your mind. I'm in this situation because I'm paying for the consequence of my behavior. And this is what I'm paying for. It's my sin. I'm reaping what I don't sow. I'm getting retribution because I don't sin against God and I don't follow evil ways. Stubbornness is idolatry. Rebellion is the spirit of witchcraft. Argumentative. People that love to argue. People that just easy to blow up. They got no peace. They're blind. They can't see even if it's right there in their face. They can't recognize the devil. They can't recognize anointed people. People will pretend like they're being delivered or fall out on the floor. I told a young lady one day when she fell out on the floor, I said, you haven't been delivered, you're playing games. She was shocked because she knew I was anointed, but she was playing games in the altar with another prophetess who claims she's a prophetess, but she's not anointed. Like the son of Siva, you're not anointed if you're playing games. You have not been delivered. You have a long way to go. And sometimes it's difficult because the person is just make barriers. And we find pride as a barrier. You go to church and you see people, they're living in sin. Church is not the way it is. God is holy, holy, holy. And he wants us to be sanctified and holy. He wants us to be spiritually mature so we can overcome our own sinfulness and our sinful patterns of behavior. So God wants us to be equipped with the power of the Holy Spirit gifts. But before that Holy Spirit gift can come in, that house got to be cleansed. That house got to be those lost friends in there, those lost familiar spirits running around in your head, in your hand, in your feet, those wrong spirits that dictate to you, those evil voices have to be evicted out of that temple and cleansed and then deposit the word of God in you in order for you to get the Holy Spirit. You just can't come up to the altar and say, I want to accept the Lord, and then you get the Holy Spirit, you start speaking in tongues. The devil is a liar. One time I was sitting up here and say, oh, I accepted the Lord, and I went up here and accepted the Lord. You accepted the Lord without asking for forgiveness for your sin? Who prayed for you? Who prayed for you? Nobody prayed for me. But they told me to just say, la 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 la, and I got the Holy Spirit. No, you don't have the Holy Spirit. You're still sleeping with a married man, with Susan Hoffman. You're still wicked. You're still going on the psychic hotline. You're still a liar and think I'm stealing money out of the register on your job. You see, they have lied to us. They have led us to believe in their own satanic doctrines of devil and demons. You have to first repent. And repentance means I want to change my life. I want to follow Jesus. I want to obey the word of God. I want to do it God's way, not my way, Lord, but your way. Not my way, Lord, but have your way, oh Lord, with me. Have your way. Have your way. I turn my body, my spirit, and my soul over to you, oh Lord. I turn my finances over to you, oh Lord. I turn my husband and my children over to you. I turn my life over to you. I'm going to walk for Jesus. I'm going to walk with Jesus. I'm going to talk to Jesus. I'm going to live for Jesus. I'm going to talk with God. I shall be sitting at the table right now. I'll be eating a lot of spiritual food. This is the spiritual food that Jesus said we must eat. Bread of heaven. I said the bread of heaven has come down. He was crucified. He rose on his third day. And now he's sitting at the right hand of the Father. And the one that is coming next is the fake Jesus. I said the fake devil has to come first because the devil is a liar. And six come before seven and he's a liar. He couldn't do his signs and wonders, but his name is Antichrist. Who is the Antichrist? Antichrist means fake Jesus, fake law, fake Savior, fake Emmanuel. He is a fake. Who is he? He is Lucifer himself. Revelation chapter 12, verse 9 will tell you who is the Antichrist. Everything is written. Jesus said in his word, it is written. It is written. I said the voodoo priest can save you. The psychic hotline cannot save you. The ritualist, the palm reader cannot save you. The tarot card cannot save you. But only thing that can save us is the blood of Jesus. You see, they can build a little time machine and claim, okay, that's a computer over there. It can go back in your past. No, the only thing that can go back to your past is the blood. Jesus is the one who can go back to the pinpoint your sin and destroy the evil yokes, destroy the strongholds in your life, destroy the family lineage curses and the generational curses. He can destroy satanic disease and infirmity. Jesus specializes in going back to the past. It doesn't matter what you did 30, 40 years ago, but Jesus is the one. I say, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me white as snow? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. It is Jesus. Jesus paid the price on Calvary. Jesus is life. The life of Jesus. We are followers of Jesus Christ, so we call ourselves Christians. We follow our leader. He leads us and we follow. There is no other way. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. I said, Peter can't do it, Confucius can't do it, but Alexander can't do it, and Greek can't do it, and Phobia can't do it, come on, Money Walker can't do it, come on, the genie can't do it, the money can't do it, and none of the wicked gods on this world, we are in heaven on the heavens, because Satan sits in this one, and is the first heaven, and the second heaven, that's where the stone is, only the spirit of wickedness, they can't do it. There was a young lady who was on a book from island to island to country to country. A beautiful girl, but she used to walk up and down Memorial Wesley Chapel all over with false madness. Talking to herself, she was mad. And for years, she was walking up and down. And her family gave up on her. They got businesses, all kind of stuff here. They gave up on her. She can sing as beautiful like a bird. They'll be backup singer for a lot of artists. And one day, when me and Brother Jay was leaving, somebody ran into the building. I went to run into the building and I said, oh, I said, lock the door. Lock the door, Brother Jay. Lock it and bolt it good, because she ain't getting out of here. I said, who are you? And what do you want? I said, give me the bottle of anointing oil. I put the anointing oil and I threw it in the face. I said, you spirit of malice. Receive the blood of Jesus. I said, you spirit of madness. She was on the floor in 2 seconds. That's what you call exercising your spiritual authority and your spiritual muscle. And she squirmed and squirmed and squirmed, and she made that kind of confession. It was done to her by her friend. She took her to the house of a witch and told her, this woman will make you sing even better. She was born with a talent, because singing is not the gift of the Holy Spirit, it's a talent. Is a spiritual talent. And we all can sing, whether we sound like a frog or not. I said, put her in a bed. There's a layer in this bed, and whatever ritual they did on earth, when she went and sing, she fell down. Because she was due to get a contract by Sony Records. And she put this day, she had never got that song contract. She was delivered. She's in a church, she's baptized, she went back to college, she's driving. Her mother came to see who I was. And the mother looked around and then she said, I'm her mother. And she threw herself on her knees, the mother and her sister. I said, Mama, get up. Get up. Don't you do that. Get up, that's blaspheme. Get up in the name of Jesus. She said, that's your daughter? And the mama broke down. She said, you don't know how much money I spent on this girl. She said, $100,000. Just do ritual. Sacrifice. I said, Jesus is free. I said, ma'am, Jesus is free. He paid a price. I said, you can't pay me. You can't pay God for what he's done in your daughter's life. That woman cried like a baby. You cannot pay me. I'm a servant of the Lord. I'm on the table. You can't pay Jesus. You see, when people love the Lord, come on, you must love the Lord. When you get to know him, you get to know Jesus, get to know him. Bury yourself up in him. just to build yourself up in a relationship with God. You see, a lot of people don't understand me. They'll say I'm crazy, cuckoo. They say she's lunatic. She's one of them crazy preachers. Them people who got demons, don't come near to her. She's going to slay you in the spirit. Whatever. They did the same thing to Jesus. They will do it to you. If they call Jesus crazy, if they call him a bastard, if they say he had a Nazarene accent, Peter had one too, they'll do the same thing to you. We are not greater than our master. But what I'm trying to teach today is like, you must make a stand. Stand in the authority that God has given you against every form of bondage in your family. Whether it is sickness, sexual promiscuity. Sometimes in families we have people that they stay constantly in and out of jail. Jail. We have families where we have a heavy curse of poverty and failure in marriage. The woman cannot stay married. The woman cannot stay in a relationship with a man. Men always cheat on them. They never get a man to really treat them right. They have a lot of children out of wedlock. This one, another baby father. Those are family witchcraft bondage. They are bondaging there. Somebody did something and the family inherits a curse. One man can curse his whole family. One woman can curse her bloodline. Many children today are suffering because of their parents. They're suffering because of things that their grandparents did and they passed it down, even sickness through the DNA. We pray today to God that you will be enlightened through the power of the Holy Spirit to overcome your family witchcraft bondage, to overcome every negativity and negative area in your life, to be able to muster up the strength and the faith and your belief in Christ Jesus and in the Word, that you must love the Word of God and dig deep and say, I am a Christian. Christian is a good thing. There's nobody more powerful than a Christian. Because the power lies through faith in Christ Jesus. No man or woman coming to the Father except through Christ Jesus. They can go and ring around the roses and they can talk about money. They can keep their money. They want power. They want silver and gold, expensive living, and the good things of this world. So they sell your soul to the kingdom of darkness. What does it profit a man to gain the world and lose his soul? What does it profit a man to gain the world and lose his soul? Hold on. Hold on to God, hold on to God, no matter your condition, the devil only comes to destroy us with his lies. The soul of sin must die, the wages of sin is death, and the soul of sin must die, the wages of sin is death, and the soul of sin must die. Father God, in the name of Jesus. Oh, touch the heart. Open up your heart to the Lord in this spiritual deliverance. This week was programmed for spiritual deliverance. But Monday, the enemy messed up on the line. He always tried to do these little things. You see, he is the prince of the air. But he cannot win the battle. Because the war is already won by Jesus. You need strength. Pull your strength from the power of the Word. The power of the Holy Spirit will give you strength. The power of the blood of Jesus will strengthen you. Strengthen them, O Lord. Strengthen your soldiers. Strengthen us, your people. Give us strength. Give us strength to overcome disasters, earthquakes. Give us strength. Strengthen our mind that when we see disaster, hurricanes, tornadoes, and when we see earthquakes, when we see the carnage, because the time is coming. We have 3.5 years before World War III breakout. When you see the World War III break out, because they're making transhumans. While transhumans being produced in the lab, they're taking out the eyes of people and putting in all kind of electronic eyes so they can see at night vision. They're doing all kind of stuff. So they've already been dealing around it for 30, 40 years. Taking the DNA of animals and mixing it with humans. They're doing all kind of stuff right here in the United States. Abominations being done on a daily basis in this nation, in the land. Millions and billions of dollars being allocated for the last 8, 10, 16, 20, 30 years to certain labs to produce these transhumans. To do satanic agenda, depopulation of human, bringing down the society to 500 million. How are they going to do that? Because the word of God says, if God does not shorten the days, no flesh will survive. So we cannot live in fear. Again, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind. I pray today that you will receive the love of God, the power of the Holy Spirit, and a sound mind comes over, and you will fight the fight. Fight the fight. Tell the devil, get thee behind me, Satan, in the name of Jesus. I resist the devil, and he shall flee. Flee from you. I said, when he smells the breath, he can look at you 100 miles. The devil will turn the other way and go. When you see the billows and the thunderstorms, so then lift up your right hand and you command the storm to turn around and go the other way. That storm will go the other way. That tornado will turn around and go. One day we were driving, Sister, we was in the country here in Georgia. And we were going somewhere, me and Sister Barbara Warwick. And Sister Barbara Warwick, she looked up and said, tornado. And everybody was saying, tornado. And she said, that's a tornado. I said, tornado, come. We started around. And that tornado turned around and went the other way. See, you got the power. You got the power in your tongue to bring death or life in your situation that you're in right now. You can bring death or life. Remember to fast. Remember to pray. You can do a soft fast. No breakfast, no lunch. Okay, after prayer, you can go eat lunch 3 o'clock. Wait till 3 o'clock. Wait till 6 o'clock. Eat your dinner. But learn how to give God some time available where you will have some spiritual food coming in that you're doing now. Everything can't wait till Sunday. Some people have to work on Sunday. Some people only have this little time at noon, from 12 noon to 1:15, because they will cut me off at a certain time. They're getting ready to cut off. Only up to a certain time they will to receive some true food from God. This is food we are eating. This is the bread of heaven. Jesus is our bread of heaven. Bread of heaven, bread of heaven, dear Lord, feed me till I want no more. Holy Spirit, precious blood of Christ, feed me, Lord, feed my soul, feed me till I want no more. Bread of heaven, bread of heaven, dear Lord, feed me till I want no more. Holy Spirit, precious blood of Christ, feed me, Lord, feed me, Lord, feed me, Lord, feed me till I want no more. That's a good place here. Praise the Lord, my brothers and sisters. I love you in the Lord. May the Lord be with you. May the blood of Jesus cover you. May the Holy Spirit guide you and keep you. May he keep you and bless you coming in and coming out. May he bless you richly, guide you and keep you and protect you and heal your body, your family, and your soul. In Jesus' mighty name. And again, tomorrow we'll be back on, if God willing, at 12 noon. My name here is Pastor The Past. You can visit us at spiritualselfdefense.com. Read about the book. And also, you can go to YouTube and put in resurrectingyourspiritministry.org. Be encouraged and remember, defeat Satan in the name of Jesus. Luke chapter 10:19. I defeat you, Satan, in the name of Jesus. I defeat you, Satan, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.